move on to the next speaker, Dr. Daniel Solorzano, who is professor of social science and comparative education in the Graduate School of Education and Information Studies at the University of California, Los Angeles. Danny has graciously agreed to join us amid a conference that he's attending in San Diego. So thank you, Danny. His talk today is entitled Racial Affirmations as a Response to Everyday Racism in Academic and Social Spaces. So Danny, please share with us your slides and take it away.
There we go. Forgot how to remove that. There you go. All right. Again, I want to thank Anthony Burroughs and Anthony Ong and Sarah Harrington for inviting me to share my work with our colleagues here. The title has changed a bit since the title you mentioned, Anthony. It's now called Racial Microaggressions and Racial Microaffirmation: Origin Stories and Case Studies. And I should say that in the interest of time, I had to remove a couple of slides that sort of focus on the theoretical underpinnings of this work, which is critical race theory, but we can engage in that in the Q&A if you'd like. And so the agenda here is that I'm going to talk about pivotal moments, origin stories, and case studies as the way I'm arranging my presentation today, trying to tell a story today. But I'm going to use case studies to tell that story. So case number one is going to be my pivotal moment and origin story of my work on racial microaggressions. Case number two is going to be my pivotal moment and origin story of racial microaffirmations. And then finally, we'll have a discussion, a Q&A, either after this presentation or certainly in the panel, we'll have this conversation together. And so pivotal moments and origin stories. I'm going to share quickly just a colleague of ours, Roberta Espinosa. She wrote a book called Pivotal Moments, How Educators Can Put All Students on the Path to College. And Roberta basically, I'm paraphrasing her conceptualization of pivotal moments, but I found this really important for me in my work. She calls it those interventions which involve people, places, written and visual material that can point the way towards new ideas and new ways of interpreting the world. And so I'm looking at sort of these pivotal moments in my life, you know, in how I came to do this work as really, really important. And I'm going to try to share those stories as we move forward. And so the first case is my racial microaggression pivotal moment in origin story. It takes place in 1993. This is at a time when I was first engaged in critical race theory. I had never really heard of the work until I happened on a Chronicle of Higher Education article it's actually a newspaper. I don't think it's no longer a hard copy newspaper, by Peter Monahan, who really introduced us to the concept of critical race theory in the law. And as I was engaged in doing my work, archival work, and looking at how the law was looking at critical race theory, how they're engaging with critical race theory, I came across this article by Peggy Davis called Law's Microaggression. She wrote it in 1989. You know, I read it about 4 years later. And in footnote number five, she mentions this person, C. Pierce. This happened to be Chester Pierce, and the second author is Wesley Prophet, called Homoracial Behavior in the USA. It's a two-page unpublished manuscript in 1986. But there were 10 other Pierce citations in this original piece that I found on Law's Microaggression. And to be clear, I had never seen the word microaggression before. It's the first time I saw it. And it sort of led, so this was a pivotal moment because it led me down this path to Chester Pierce and his work on racial microaggressions. He is now passed on, but he's a professor of psychiatry and education at Harvard University's Medical School and their Graduate School of Education. If you ask me, Danny, where would you start to look at Chester Pierce's work? Although there's a piece that comes right before this, 1969, I would actually start here, this chapter in Fred Barber's The Black 70s, 1970 book. The chapter is called Offensive Mechanisms, where he basically introduces us to in how he came to do the work on racial microaggressions. And he gives examples in multiple contexts where he talks about racial microaggressions. I think it's a really, really important again, pivotal moment, but really important a piece for me as I began to do my work on racial microaggressions. But in this piece, this is what Chet said. He said, the major and overriding psychiatric problem of the Black minority is the withering effect of racism. Hence, the sociocultural and community aim must be to dilute, undercut, and eliminate racism wherever and however it was located. And so, again, I think Chet was talking to us 52 years ago in ways that are so relevant in 2022. Actually, it's more than it's 52 years. I think he's still speaking to me, and I still engage with him through his readings. And I keep rereading his work and learning more about how he approached the study of racial microaggressions. And so how do I define, or how do we define racial microaggressions? So I say that racial microaggressions are one form of systemic everyday racism used to keep those at the racial margins in their place. I wanted to say that racial microaggressions are verbal and nonverbal assaults directed towards people of color. And I should be clear here that my work focuses on people of color, right? And again, these are verbal and nonverbal assaults. We can talk about, you know, the differences between the two, but we're most often familiar with the verbal assaults and less familiar with the nonverbal assaults, like statuary or other sorts of visual sort of renditions or assaulted renditions directed towards people of color. They're layered assaults. They could be based on a person of color's race, her gender, her class, her sexuality, her language, immigration status, phenotype, accent, or surname. But it's this sort of intersectional approach that I think is really, really important as we look at and define and do work on racial microaggressions. And then finally, they're cumulative assaults, meaning it's not just one, it's the accumulation of these everyday assaults that really take a physiological, a psychological, and an academic toll on people of color. And we'll talk about that in a second. And so this is the model that I use to try to understand racial microaggressions, where we talk about the types on the upper left-hand corner. We talk about the racial microaggressions. We talk about the context in which they occur, but we also talk about the effects. You know, how do racial microaggressions impact people on the receiving end? And also how people of color respond to racial microaggressions. And as you can see in the middle, there's a bidirectional arrow, because when people respond, when people of color respond to a racial microaggression, it in turn has an effect on them. And we can talk about that as well. And so effects. And I'm going to share with you a story. Dr. David Williams is a professor of public health, African-American studies, and sociology at Harvard University. And this is called the Everyday Discrimination Story. And David's work is really, really important on talking about the impact of everyday racism on people of color. And so I'm going to share a quick clip. It's April 18, 2021, just about a year ago. 60 Minutes had Bill Whitaker had the segment on race and health, in which he introduced us to David Williams and some of the work of David Williams. So here, I'll share this with you.
Dr. David Williams, who is originally from the Caribbean island of St. Lucia, is a professor of public health at Harvard and chairman of its Department of Social and Behavioral Sciences. He has spent a quarter century researching the corrosive impact that racism has on the health of people of color all around the world.
You have conducted rigorous psychological, sociological, scientific studies of this phenomenon.
That's correct. We've done studies in South Africa, their colleagues doing studies in Australia, studies in the UK, studies across the world, and we find in all of these contexts, empirically, statistically, that experiences of discrimination are directly impacting health.
Can something as complex and subjective as racial discrimination really be measured? Williams insists it can, with a test that he created nearly 25 years ago.
What is the Everyday Discrimination Scale?
The Everyday Discrimination Scale is a measure, a 9-item measure. It has items like you're treated with less courtesy than others, you're treated with less respect than others, you receive poorer service than others in restaurants or stores, people act as if they're afraid of you. It's little ways in which your dignity is chipped away on a daily basis. And what we are finding is that persons who score high on the Everyday Discrimination Scale have a broad range of adverse health conditions. It predicts high blood pressure. It predicts the onset of diabetes. It predicts incident cardiovascular disease. It predicts poorer mental health.
Professor Williams has demonstrated that the health of Black Americans suffers, whether they are rich or poor, well-educated or not. Black women with college degrees are more likely to see their babies die as infants than white women who didn't finish high school.
So he's raising a number of different questions, and he's utilizing a survey that I think is really, really important for us to consider and use if we're already not using it in our research. And really, he's talking about the impact of stress, of race-related stress on health outcomes. So in that everyday discrimination scale, he talks about the stress related to being treated with less courtesy than other people are. He's talking about receiving poor service than other people in restaurants or stores. He's talking about people acting as if they're afraid of you. He's talking about people being followed around in stores. He's talking about, these are four of the nine items that he mentioned, but the stress related to being engaged with this in the everyday has negative health outcomes, which include, as he mentioned, high blood pressure, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and mental health. So again, I think he's moving us, and he's been moving us for 25 years at least, to look at the importance of understanding the relationship between discrimination, everyday discrimination, which I would call racial microaggressions, on health outcomes and other outcomes, as we can talk about later. So the effects are obviously the poor health outcomes that Dr. Williams mentioned in that short clip. It's also that they're very painful. They hurt, these everyday forms of racial discrimination. You get angry or you get stressed as a result of this, or what our colleague at the University of Utah, William Smith, calls racial battle fatigue sets in. You have self-doubt, or the imposter syndrome might set in as an effect. And as we mentioned, it can affect one's academic performance, either on tests or in school or in other educational settings. But responses is another area that I want to focus on now. And responses to racial microaggressions are that we police ourselves, we self-police. We don't go to certain stores, we don't go to certain restaurants, we don't go to certain neighborhoods. And so that's one of the ways, and actually David Williams has actually a vigilance scale as part of his arsenal of surveys that he uses to study the impact of everyday racism. We want to prove them wrong is another example of a response to everyday racism. Self-preservation is another response, or what people often engage in around healing circles, those sorts of self-preservation spaces. Resistance, people push back against everyday racism or structural racism or white supremacy. I think ethnic studies and the study of ethnic history, racial and ethnic history, are probably examples of resistance, both in historical and contemporary forms. We create counter spaces, academic and social counter spaces, in schools, in workplaces, in communities, etc. Art forms, or various art forms. I'm here in San Diego right now, and right across the street and down the block, there's an exhibit that's closing on Sunday by an artist, a Chicana, Mexican-American artist, Yolanda Lopez. And it's an amazing example about a resistance and pushback against everyday racism and sexism and sexuality in her artwork. And I'm going to try to get over to see that exhibit before I leave on Sunday. And then finally, racial microaffirmations, what I'll talk about in a second. And so again, as responses to racial microaggression, one of the ones I'm going to focus on is racial microaffirmations. And so that's my second case, my racial microaffirmation pivotal moment and origin story. It takes place in 1994, sort of a year after I was doing that work on racial microaggressions and engaged in that literature. And these are stories of the nod as racial microaffirmations. And they really come from a book that I was reading at the time. I actually used it at one of my seminars when I was at UCLA. When I first got there, I got there in 1990. But 1994, I used Hemi Lewis Gates's memoir called Color People. And there's a letter to his daughters that starts the memoir that I really recommend you take a look at. But it's a powerful story to his daughters that led me to this work on the knot. Not 1994, it comes much, much later, but it clearly was influenced by Henry Louis Gates's memoir. But racial microaffirmations, I argue, take place within the context of institutional racism and white supremacy. And so racial microaffirmations can be a simple gesture, a social gesture, or greeting that one might give to one another. It could also be in acknowledging another's presence. It could be a signal or gesture of solidarity that one would give to another. It would be a gesture of respect. It could be a simple, I appreciate you, or it could be a very subtle, I see you. And so again, they take place within the context of institutional racism. So I say that racial microaffirmations are the everyday ways that people of color respond to institutional racism. And so I'm gonna share just something, a piece of that was written by Dr. Manning. It's a story of the black knot in medicine. And so Dr. Manning, Kimberly Manning, wrote this piece in the Journal of the American Medical Association in 2014. It's called The Knot. And she says this, she says, I just entered the emergency department with the team to see a last of our new admissions on a busy call day. Out of habit, more than anything else, my eyes scanned the area as we walked. One of the first people I noticed was a nurse with striking brown skin contrasted with nearly all white hair. She appeared to be quite busy, yet instinctively she paused when she saw me. In those fleeting seconds, her face became warm and familiar, and then, just like that, she offered me a tiny head dip of salutation. I returned the gesture, and that was that. A few steps later, I noticed an elderly man leaning on a gurney with an old four-pronged cane. Although he was in the middle of conversing with his doctor, he darted his eyes in my direction and shot me the tiniest downward nod of his head. It was so subtle that I'd have missed it unless I'd understood to expect it, but I did. So well that nod, my own nod in his direction occurred in near perfect synchrony with his. I always believe that the innate cultural nods I give to my people each day don't polarize, they instead unify. Like most things I do instinctively, I will likely continue to do this whether I'm thinking about it or not. Even still with all people, I will also consciously strive to have my actions and reactions affirm those simple words that I know are not unique, but not a unique necessity to my race alone. I see you. And so, again, I think her sharing of that example, I think is really indicative. And so I ask a couple of questions in this presentation. I ask, is the presence of people of color in a place, in text, in media, in history, a microaffirmation, right? And I also ask, what do racially affirming spaces and practices look like? And so I end by just saying that I suppose a simple question, how does racial microaggressions and racial microaffirmations help us reimagine our research and practice? And so I'll leave you there, and I can share with you some of the other parts of this research in the Q&A and in the discussion at the end. So I want to thank you all for that. You're muted.
Sorry. Thank you, Danny, for sharing those pivotal moments in your journey. They certainly rang very palpable, hearing them. We do have time for questions. If you have any questions, please drop them in the chat. So I guess I'll take this opportunity to ask a question. I'm sort of really fascinated by this work on racial micro affirmations, and I really want to try to understand here, and please tell me if I'm way off. But I heard echoes of the last talk on sort of master narratives and how a sense of belonging to a marginalized group can be a kind of racial affirmation, if you will. But I guess I'm wanting to draw out this distinction, and maybe you'll not agree, but that is, do you think that, you know, what you're thinking of as racial affirmations, can they stand alone conceptually in terms of, you know, this kind of shared cultural intimacy that is needed to be in resistance to systemic racism, or can it be in itself a kind of, you know, phenomenon? I don't know if that makes sense.
Well, I think this idea of a shared cultural intimacy, as I mentioned, we borrow from Henry Louis Gates' work. And in fact, in that letter to his daughters. And so that's really foundational to the way that we're engaged in this, because, I mean, you know, people engage in racial microaffirmations for a reason. And you know, part of it is to acknowledge one another in a space, to see one another in a space. And so in many ways, it's one of those ways that we engage with each other as in many ways a form of survival in some cases. You know, I'm reading a book right now, just about finished, a book by Tamika Brown Nagin, and it's called The Queen of Civil Rights. It's about Constance Baker Motley. For those of you who don't know, you may have heard the hearings of Judge Jackson, Tamika Brown Jackson, her hearings in the Senate. She references Constance Baker Motley, and she references that she was her mentor because she knew her work. Not that she knew her personally, but she knew her work. But in the book, you're seeing and you're engaging with all these different forms of affirmations that she won't call affirmations, but there are ways that she survived as the first Black attorney in the NAACP who brought many of the cases, these civil rights cases in the 1940s, 50s, and 60s. But she talks about those ways in which she engaged with not only other attorneys in those cities where she went, but also other families and communities in those cities, mostly in the South, where she was challenging Jim Crow, whether it was James Meredith. She brought the case that went to the Supreme Court that finally let James Meredith at the University of Mississippi. I mean, she brought a number of different cases. Charlene Hunter Gault, her case when she brought it before the University of against the University of Georgia by allowing Charlene Hunter Gault to be admitted to that university, which was a segregated Jim Crow university. I mean, but in the story itself, there's these stories of affirmation and with others, and mostly it's other attorneys, clients, and people in the communities in which she was fighting these cases. So again, I want to be clear that the way I'm approaching this is that it could be also a survival technique way of surviving in a racist world. In some ways, it could be a counter narrative as opposed to a master narrative, or it challenges the counter narrative of these affirmations. And so that's how I'm approaching it, Anthony.
Thank you, Danny, for expanding on that. My colleague Tony Burrow has a question for you.
Sure.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much for these remarks. This is just a fascinating dive into the history, the historical situating of microaffirmations against the backdrop of microaggressions. And I just appreciate the arc that you shared with your own experiences, but also your scholarly, you know, path to this work. And along that pathway, as you drew this out, I had a wondering about the micro in these experiences. I almost wonder, what is micro about them? The stark contrast about linking microaggressions to hospitalizations in the imagery itself as undermining health and well-being, as Dr. David Williams, has his scholarship shows. And I almost wonder, in the microaggression literature, what seems micro is that the experiences themselves aren't small, but they're fleeting, they're acute. It's an experience of disrespect while you're shopping or something, as opposed to as a chronic experience out, you know, of underlying. It's sort of a fleeting experience that makes them micro. So it's an articulation of how acute they are in experience, not their impact. Yeah. And then I think about the affirmations and how, in my own experience, something like a nod could contribute to a deep sense of belonging in a space that kept me in there when I otherwise may have left, and what then happened to my learning. And so I wonder, though, is the articulation of micro a recognition that for other people, maybe the audience for whom may not even see these things, you're saying, well, this is sort of small to you, but if you think about microaggressions as undermining health and well-being, maybe even shortening lifespans, and microaffirmations potentially allowing you to persist in a space, as you just said, sort of the profound ways micro is, are these actually micro? Is that a fitting sort of adjective to describe these experiences? Or yeah, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, thanks, Anthony. You know, what I would do, I I go back to Chester Pierce and I go back to that 1970 chapter, Offensive Mechanisms, because he would say, and he's told us, that micro and microaffirmation or microaggressions doesn't mean less than. The micro and microaggressions means in the everyday. So that's how he's framed it. And so it's these everyday assaults against people of color. You use the word fleeting. Yes, they could be fleeting assaults, but they're certainly assaults. But again, I think it's the everyday that I think Chet has really sort of helped us understand why he used the word micro, because he too was challenged back in the 1970s when he first introduced this concept to our fields, right, to the community. And he had his own ideas how he wanted to deal with it too. I mean, he wanted to train community social workers in every community, Black community, to deal with these everyday forms of racism that people, that Black people are experiencing. Answers to some of these questions really keep me going back to Chet, and, you know, having Chet sort of reschool me, or, you know, help me rethink ideas. So that's how I would respond, Anthony.
Thank you,
Danny.